Non-invasive ventilation is a potentially life-saving intervention in patients with acute respiratory failure. It provides treatment without the need for endotracheal intubation. When used correctly, non-invasive ventilation can be successful and reduce mortality by approximately 50% in patients with type 2 respiratory failure. However, despite its advantages, patients often find it difficult to tolerate, and this can stop them from benefiting from the treatment. How we approach patients during NIV setup can help them understand the treatment more and be able to tolerate it better. This video is going to take you through a patient-centered setup of non-invasive ventilation. Before starting a patient on NIV, there are five essential things to think about. The first one being, is NIV indicated? NIV works to improve your gas exchange. There are two main settings. The first being your IPAP, or inspiratory positive airway pressure, and the second being your EPAP, the expiratory positive airway pressure. Your IPAP, your inspiratory positive airway pressure, aims to improve hypercapnia by increasing your ventilation and your tidal volume. Your EPAP, expiratory positive airway pressure, aims to improve oxygenation by increasing recruitment and improving lung compliance. Therefore, non-invasive ventilation is used in the treatment of acute hypercapnic respiratory failure or those with excessive work of breathing. It is important to identify the clinical indication for using non-invasive ventilation. If used inappropriately, it can make the clinical problem worse. Before starting NIV, it's important to check there are no contraindications to treatment. Therefore, before starting NIV, you should ensure the patient has had an ABD to determine type 2 respiratory failure unless they have excessive work of breathing, and ensure the patient has a chest x-ray to rule out a pneumothorax. The second essential thing, NIV is supportive and not a treatment in its own right. Therefore, it's important to ensure that the underlying medical problem has been treated. For example, patients admitted with an acute acidotic exacerbation of COPD should receive five key things before being commenced on NIV. These include controlled oxygen, usually via venturi mask, a nebulized bronchodilator, a steroid, antibiotics, and a chest x-ray. Thirdly, is the patient in a safe place to administer NIV? Patients being treated with NIV are acutely unwell and have the potential to deteriorate rapidly. Starting a patient on acute NIV may initially make the patient worse. For example, EPAP, or expiratory positive airway pressure, can often decrease a patient's blood pressure. Therefore, it is essential when NIV is set up that the patient is in an area where they can have continuous monitoring, including heart rate and SATS monitoring, and that they are set up by someone competent to do so. Next, has NIV been explained to the patient and/or their next of kin? Non-invasive ventilation can be scary and uncomfortable for patients. It is therefore essential that we provide careful explanation on the process of what NIV involves and ensure we have consent to continue. There is written literature available. However, in the acute situation, it may be more appropriate to provide a careful verbal explanation. And finally, has a shared decision been made with the patient about their ceilings of care? Having a plan for treatment failure is really important, particularly in the event of acute deterioration. These five essential items are included in the NIV care bundle on Cerna. This should be completed before the patient is initiated on NIV. Non-invasive ventilation should also be prescribed on Cerna. This allows you to document the aims and settings clearly. NIV should be set up by a competent practitioner. Before setting up, ensure all equipment is available, including a humidified circuit, different size masks, and a humidifier box. Plug the V60 in and connect to the walled oxygen. Connect the circuit with pressure line to the ventilator, ensuring there is a bacterial filter within the circuit. This is the humidification box. Attach the water chamber to the heating plate, then attach to a bag of sterile water. Attach the bacterial filter to the circuit and then attach to the ventilator. Attach the other end of the short circuit to the humidification box. Next, prepare the mask using the larger piece of the circuit by attaching to the humidification box and place the port at the patient end. Attach an appropriate size mask and ensure the pressure cable is attached at both the ventilator and mask end. Once the circuit is connected, it is important to select the correct size mask for the patient. Switch on the machine and select the appropriate interface in the mask port section under menu. This should correlate with the expiratory port number on the selected mask. In the mode section, select ST. This means spontaneous with timed backup, meaning the patient is breathing spontaneously, but if they happen to go apneic, the machine will provide them with breaths. The first thing to set is the initial inspired oxygen, or FiO2. This will depend on your patient's condition and the underlying medical problem. In most cases, especially those with type 2 respiratory failure in COPD, we would usually be aiming for saturations between 88 and 92%. It's important that the FiO2 is adjusted to achieve the appropriate saturation and oxygen levels. Next, select the IPAP, the inspiratory positive airway pressure. This should be started between 10 to 15 centimeters of water. Next, select the EPAP, the expiratory positive airway pressure. Generally, we set this around 4 centimeters of water. Next, select the rate. This is the backup rate. This is the rate if the patient goes apneic, will be the number of breaths the patient receives from the ventilator within a minute. We generally start this between 12 and 16, but once the patient is on the ventilator, it may require changing. Next is the inspiratory time. This is the time you're allowing the patient to inspire during the cycle. Changing the inspiration time will alter the I to E ratio. We generally set a 1-to-2 ratio for patients. The next setting is the rise time. This is how quick we are delivering the breaths. The rise time ranges from 1 to 5. 1 is a quick rate, 5 is slow. When setting the rise time, we tend to start at a faster rise time, around 1 to 2. This is because patients tend to have a higher work of breathing when they initially started on NIV. Once the patient is settled on NIV, you may need to change the rise time. Once you have set the machine on the starting settings, activate ST mode. It is now time to fit the mask to the patient. Before fitting, you should provide careful explanation of what you are about to do. Firstly, introduce yourself to the patient. Explain to them that you are going to fit a tight-fitting mask onto their face.
We're going to size up a new mask for you today, which is going to help you with your breathing. So if it's okay, Diana will size that up for you, and then we'll get going with the machine.
Hi TV, so I'm just going to size up, which is the most appropriate. We'll do the face mask first. I think this looks a bit smaller. Okay, I think probably the medium would be the most appropriate. I would also want to check the full face, because this is more comfortable. Yeah. I think a full face, large one should be most appropriate for you. Okay, are you happy?
Yeah.
Explain to the patient that you are going to fit the mask. The mask will have to be quite tight and held on by straps. This mask will be connected to the ventilator, which will help with their breathing. Explain to them that the mask may be uncomfortable at first. Once the mask is fitted, check the mask for any excessive leak, and ensure the patient knows how to both take the mask off and call for help if needed. It is important to stay with the patient while they get used to being on the ventilator and ensure they are as comfortable as possible. The patient should remain on continuous monitoring for at least the first 12 hours of treatment or until the initial respiratory acidosis has resolved. Now the patient has been commenced on NIV, the aim is to increase the IPAP to around 20 in the first 10 to 30 minutes of treatment. If you reach a level of an IPAP of, say, 16 or 18, and the patient starts to not tolerate, then it's okay to leave them on this setting. After an hour of the patient being on optimal settings, a repeat ABG should be taken. This will allow you to guide your treatment further. At the top of the V60 screen, you will see all your patient feedback. The other key feature is to look at the patient leak. This tells you the amount of leak from the mask. The machine can overcome some leak. However, if this is increasing too much, it is likely you're not ventilating your patient efficiently. No leak at all on the machine means that your mask is too tight and you can loosen the straps. However, too much leak, anywhere between 40 and 60, will mean that you're not ventilating your patient efficiently. Therefore, the mask may need to be readjusted, the straps readjusted, or a different size mask fitted. Following initiation and after any change in settings, an arterial blood gas should be taken at 1 hour. In the event of clinical deterioration, it is important to repeat a gas to ensure your patient's CO2 isn't rising further. If your patient is likely to need multiple ABGs, it will be worth considering whether they need an arterial line, remembering this determines which clinical area they can be managed in. When you repeat your gas, if your CO2 remains high, increase the tidal volume by increasing the IPAP. If the patient remains hypoxic on the gas, increase the EPAP or the FiO2. Remember, you may need to increase the IPAP to maintain tidal volumes. Ensure the NIV prescription is updated and repeat the ABG 1 hour after any settings change. While the patient is on NIV, there are things to consider to ensure the treatment is as effective as possible. For example, if the patient is becoming intolerant of treatment, you may consider changing some settings, including the rise time, the eye time, or the backup rate. You may also consider a referral to chest physiotherapy to help improve tolerance, airway clearance, and patient positioning. The guideline on the source provides more information on how to troubleshoot common problems. If the patient does not improve and continues to deteriorate, it would be worth considering a referral to ICU. This should have been decided in advance and a shared decision made with the patient before starting NIV. If the patient isn't for escalation, then a referral to palliative care should be made early. Patients not tolerating NIV may also benefit from a referral to palliative care for help with symptom control for tolerance. The NIV algorithm is there to help guide you through this early treatment of a patient in type 2 respiratory failure requiring NIV. Now your patient is on NIV, ensure you regularly check their pressure areas, particularly around the mask. Ensure they receive physio and refer to any other specialities as required, including dietitian or speech and language therapy. Staff looking after patients on NIV should ensure that they receive regular training and complete their NIV competencies. In conclusion, the key things to take away are: is NIV indicated? Has the underlying medical problem been treated? Is the patient in a safe place to administer NIV? Has NIV been explained to the patient and/or their next of kin? Has a shared decision been made with the patient about their CERN of care? Then complete the NIV bundle and CERN a prescription. And finally, safe, effective, and patient-centered care equals high-quality care.